It's our Christmas trip. Yay!
Our Christmas cruise. We started in Vienna, went to St. Stephen's Cathedral, went to the Christmas markets there, saw many of the sights. Then we got on our river boat, went down the Danube, went to Melk, where we saw the Melk Monastery.
Abbey.
Melk Abbey. Got back on the boat, went down a ways, past Linz.
Actually, we're going up river.
Up river, past Linz. And the next town we visited was Passau. It was a beautiful town, smaller than many of the towns we saw, but beautiful. Beautiful architecture. Nice Christmas market.
Lots of bridges and locks.
Lots of bridges and locks in between. Then we went up to Regensburg, which is noted for its Christmas stolen.
Where did we have sausages? The oldest sausage factory in the world. Wasn't it in Regensburg?
No, I'm not sure. Maybe it was in Regensburg. I'm not sure. Or it could have been Nuremberg, one of those places. From Regensburg, we went to Nuremberg, and they are known for their gingerbread. Went to Christmas markets in all of these towns. And Nuremberg being the last stop, we took a bus from there and went to Munich and spent the day in Munich. Had a great time walking around the city, seeing the Glockenspiel.
Glockenspiel.
In the city at one of the big Christmas markets. And we had a great lunch in a little German restaurant where they had
Hempstead, something like that, is a ham hocks.
Ham hocks. John and Ken had the ham hocks. Walter, Diana, and I had the sausage and sauerkraut.
So that's our trip. We'll go in and look at some details next.
Very close.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Cheers.
Okay.
Cheers. Salute. Here we go.
Yeah.
We did better.
Three more. Oh, yeah. This is the group. We have a few more.
A few more than this, but we're trying to assemble.
And if you want some salt and for coffee or
we're in the bar. The night before, tour the town and get on the boat. Where we just had our martinis.
I would just want to ask before we hit the road that you empty the safety deposit box and you have your wallets, your passports, your traveling documents, all those things. So if I really wanted to see 15 passports, that would be possible. So you have them for sure. Mm-hmm. Okay, last time I told my people to let the night before we leave somewhere, put one of your shoes in the safety deposit box. Because that helps a lot.
Yeah.
So we got everything. Everybody has checked out. All right. I believe we had 30 pieces of luggage. Is that correct?
We had much.
Never mind.
That was just Ken's.
And where's Ann? Oh, there they are. 4 pizzas. Good. 10, 5.
Yep.
John.
John, 4.
Oh, yeah, 4. Walt, 4. Get these. 2.
That would be me.
Becca, 2. John Ellis, I think I saw that. 2 and 2. We're going to one, so we're good. The bus is right out there. Miroslav is just loading the very last two pieces. So the bus is right out there. Up on.
So this will be the bus. It is right out there.
Hi, John.
Dibs on the front seat.
Where do we
shotgun?
How do you board? I've never been.
Everybody on the bus.
How do you board? You walk in. It's like a school bus.
Okay.
Here we go.
We're not so lucky. Hail to the victors, valiant.
Yay! Go blue.
Must be Michigan, huh?
It is. The ring. We're out of here.
And really took the Ottomans by surprise. They just hadn't expected them to come from that side. And imagine that in the time when Prince Eugene had this as his summer palace, Vienna was only St. Stephen's Cathedral, a very small city around with the fortifications, and none of the other buildings, higher buildings, also the older higher buildings, of course, had not existed. I mean, the church was there, the Cilician church, the big one, but anything else was gone or had been there. And on the low end of the hill is the lower Belvedere, which was his residence. And it's really less impressive because that's only where he had lived. Whereas here, he made all the receptions and had to impress the people. So this was the idea. In a Baroque garden, you always had a little world, like on the foothill. On the foothill is the forest with all the trees there. And the higher you come up, like as if you were climbing up a mountain, the lower the vegetation becomes lesser. And then you reach the top of the hill, which is the Olympus and the Olympus. And he was also considered one of these ones. Like the god of fiction. Okay.
There we are, outside the lovely museum. That's it. I'm hanging out on the shop stuff. Buy anything you want. Searching away. You don't want any of it. So what were you going to say? Something?
Yes.
What? Something brilliant?
No.
Mm-hmm. One way to quiet you down is to put you on camera. Look at this glass.
Tiffany.
Doesn't look like the Tiffany, eh? Remember?
Okay.
In the shadow of the
Belvedere Palace.
Belvedere Palace. So that's just, you got lots of things going on here. The languages. Sounds like Dolly Parton singing over there.
I would like to give you a very short historical overview just to know the basic dates because we are a quite old manufactory. Then we're going to look at the back of the building, what our actual production is. Although I have to inform you at the beginning that today is Saturday, so my colleagues are not really working. Although still we're going to be able to look at their actual workplaces. And if there are any questions, do please let me know. In case we, as long as we have enough time, I would be happy to answer any questions that are coming up. And also in case, you know, example, they are of course faulty, they survived the firing, and everything is perfectly fine. Then we use so-called metal oxide pigments. Metal oxide pigments means So in this case, so this is basically the metal oxide pigments, in this case green. And these are
green. And these are
mixed together with turpentine oil and then applied. So always we have these glass plates on which we mix the paints together. And then we apply them with quills, brushes, or even sponges, for example. We have a tiny piece that looks like a bread roll, for example, that's outside, painted on with a tiny sponge to have the different variations of brown colors, for example. So we paint in them with these colors, and then we fire them again. So all the painted pieces have been fired for at least 3 times. Meaning that they have been fired twice, whiteware production, and then at least for another time in the painting department. In this firing, the glaze does not melt anymore as it did in the second firing, where it actually really combined itself with the whiteware underneath. But it gets a bit soft, and I also like to call it that it basically opens up. So it takes in the paint. If you fire it, if it takes in the paint, then when it cools off, the glaze closes again, and so therefore the paint is inside the glaze and also fixed there. So you can also put it into a dishwasher, for example.
It's a Christmas decoration.
Wie alt ist er? Dann ist das geschehen.
To clean it.
Yes.
Oh. Will I make you nervous if I watch it?
No, it's not.
It's been doing it long enough. Probably watch TV.
So this is for my first name, his
yes.
first name, and that's our last name.
It's a family,
family
name. Do we have a
script? What do you think would, I mean, it's a little area.
It's in Jugendstil. Huh?
Okay, sure.
Yeah.
Is that okay with you?
Yeah.
You don't have to whisper.
Okay. It makes my eyes fill up.
Because
it's sentimental.
You're making your pocket empty and your eyes fill up.
Double
U. Double V.
Her last name is Whipple, but you would say Whipple, V, right? Whipple. Vienna.
No, you would say Duberville.
Duberville?
It was French.
That's French. Yeah.
Duberville?
Yeah. No, V. V.
It's two V's.
You can't put the year any place, can you? Like 2016?
Yes, oh yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
Oh, there's enough
on
room?
The back side?
Oh, can you on the back
yes,
side?
Yes, yes.
Oh.
Yes.
I'm gonna say goodbye to the driver, so don't worry about that. And Joseph, thank you very much
you.
For the
thank
day.
You.
Thank you. Thank you, Joseph.
Hey, Joseph.
There we go. That's our boat over here. Those deck chairs look inviting.
Uh-huh. The lounge room is the best to hang out.
It's
got a sun deck too. You go up in the sun. And go up with your bikini and get some vitamin D. Yeah.
You know, we were on this very bike path.
I think you're right. I think this is where we came when we were approaching Vienna.
Yep.
This is right along the river, the bike path. Yeah, we were on both sides of it. One time we took a little ferry to get on the other side.
We bike and stay.
Hello.
Thank you.
Hello, welcome on board.
Well, we're on ship.
Okay. Thank you.
Doesn't have to turn green.
Green is second floor.
Oh, green is second floor.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Thank you.
Have a nice day.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
The room that we saw on.
Yeah.
On YouTube.
Beautiful. Lovely.
This is the classy room.
Oh, they have these things charging in there.
Oh, pretty good size.
It's very lovely.
That's the guy, the photographer. Yay!
My
there we are.
Yay! Look at the view. Very nice.
TV set hanging up on the wall. We got our little suite over here. And curtains will open up.
Yeah.
Dorothy will be opening this door. We have a balcony.
Yeah.
We have
lovely.
A chair out here.
Oh,
even.
Look at the sky.
This is...
Oh, look at this way.
But tonight, at this moment, I will explain you about safety on board of our ship. And for that, I also like to ask our bar staff to stop serving for the next few minutes. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, in case of an emergency, you always will hear first the general alarm, which, by the way, I'm not going to demonstrate to you right now, because there's a fire department you're right on the other side of the road, and I don't like to have them on board here for nothing. But if you hear it, believe me, it's a very loud series of beeps. It's irritating loud.
Here we are, having some dinner. Very apt. Thank you.
Are you sure we're not?
This is dinner. Getting ready. Good eat. Oh, there he goes. Dining room. Hopefully we'll be up there whenever we get there. All right. Guess I'll sit down now.
Right here behind the coffee shop, let's say. You just have to look down. We are coming from exactly from down there, from the coffee shop. And down there is that is the northern corner from Vienna. And down here the Danube River, which is going floating down to the direction east. This means the Danube River goes down to Bratislava, and of course further on then to Budapest, actually, to Hungary, and at the end to the Black Sea, we know that. Well, you have here Vienna right in front of you, and all these forests here surrounding Vienna, till down there, the hills, these are the Vienna woods, all this green land from Vienna. I spoke already before. Well, down there, where you see the skyscrapers here, right straight down here ahead of you, it's in the southwest part of the town. And right down where you have, facing the sun, down there is Vienna downtown. So this is the old historical center. While it is a little bit difficult to recognize anything at the moment, because as I said, it's exactly down there facing the sun. Golden times at the main entrance, you see, he still was influenced from his teachers. And his teachers were from the generation of Gustav Klimt. So you still have the golden influence from Gustav Klimt you actually see here in the tiles. He said as well, nothing in nature is straight. So he never ever built a floor. As well, the apartments inside are straight. The walls are a little bit steep. And so when you want to hang up a nice painting, you cannot hang the painting normally on the wall, because the wall is like this and the painting is hanging then straight down. It's really a very, very strange atmosphere to live there, actually, inside. Yeah, have a look around.
Going to the bathroom so we can see the inside of the Gaudi-ish building.
It is very Gaudi-ish.
You got done too soon. This is the bathroom that we came down to see.
Because
I we're in the wrong place again. We got lost?
There we go. There we go.
Okay, Joe, you're ready? You ready?
Yep.
Why are we ashamed?
Well, we're on our way to see the church.
the ones they still want to hear a few words of the church, I will tell you a few words. For everybody else, if you want to return to the bus, you saw straight ahead, and then there is on the right-hand side a street coming where you see a fountain. You saw sculptures. There you go to the right, and again straight you are at the same way we came now. You need 5 minutes to go there. Well, the church is now really the heart of Vienna. This means we are in the this church here was the very first building already consecrated in 1147. Since the 12th century we have a church here. It's much smaller, of course. In these days we were Bishop of Passau, and the Duke here wanted to be independent. And before you can be independent and Rome sends you an own bishopric, you need a bigger church. So the Duke gave the order to enlarge the church, and this, what you see here, was built between 1350 to about 1470. And what you see here is pure and clear German, high German Gothic. This is a Gothic cathedral. You have one bell tower, it's 136 meters high, and you have a beautiful roof. The roof was made out of 120,000 Bohemian tiles, and the pattern of this roof looks like an Oriental textile. The Oriental textiles were the most expensive things you could find in these days, and the Duke wanted to show that he can afford that, of course. Unfortunately, the roof got hit during the Second World War, not by a bomb, it was fire. The house next to the church was hit by a bomb, went on fire, and the sparks went over to the roof. And the roof was constructed out of 600-year-old woods. And this woods went on fire like paper. The whole roof burned for 3 days, and at the end of the third day, it collapsed into the church. It was a huge damage. 1955, it was rebuilt. It was restored, actually. And 55, the church was reopened with a big mess.
You like
it
the
is
weather.
Still our bishopric. It's the cool. Main church.
That like Florida. That like Naples.
You can go now inside.
One question that visitors very often ask, what was the point of having a summer palace so close to the winter palace? There can't have been a lot of climate difference here. I would say yes, there was, even if it's only 4 miles from the city center. But considering that, as I said in the morning to all those who were with me in the morning, they know that story, the water in Vienna was undrinkable, the air was unbreathable because as long as the city was standing, there was no air circulation, no ventilation. So it was a good idea to get away from the city for the summer and to be somewhere out in the, not in the middle of nowhere, but out somewhere in a green environment. And also, of course, you couldn't travel very far. It was the days before there were railways, let alone motor vehicles. And so if the country had to be rained from Schönbrunn and the royal spent the whole summer out here, then it couldn't be very far from the city center if you wanted to maintain continuity and keep control over the country. And of course it was, in addition to that, a question of prestige. If the French had their Versailles, which, come to think of it, is also not very far from the city center of Paris, the Austrians had to have their Schönbrunn.
We are back in the market, after looking at traditional Christmas market.
What's get hot cider? You know what? I would like to just try it. I've never tried.
Apple orange. Fish of hot cider? Huh?
Yeah.
Hot
cider? Yes, please.
I don't need that.
No cider for you?
No.
No cider.
No, thank you.
Berry, cherry, apple, orange.
Apple. Yeah. John,
do you want apple?
No. It doesn't matter what you say. You're getting one. I am not getting one. I am not getting one. I'm telling you.
Famous last words. The next picture will be one of him with one in his hand.
That we'll see. Because I'm the editor.
Walter? Okay, so
you have to
Walter
Schultz. Apple cider?
What's alcohol? You know,
you gotta get the one with the booze.
What is that?
Apple punch with alcohol?
Is that what you said? Traditional.
Yes. What is the other thing that goes in the apple punch?
Cinnamon?
Yeah.
Is that the best one to get?
Yes.
Okay.
The best is the one you like the most.
Okay.
How much is that?
€4. 26 altogether. €10 deposit.
26? Good camera ready.
I give you 46.
Sabotage. No.
How do you pronounce it?
The blue line over there is $2.50. Here it's $4. The punch over there is $2.50.
We're already in line. Does that include the cups?
It includes the cups, which you want to give
26,
back.
So
I don't have anything.
Here. Wait, John. Do you have
it?
Yes.
There.
I lose this battle all the way around.
Here, Ken.
All right. Let's get to drinking. There's the band playing. There's Dorothy holding my cup. Yikes. It's nasty.
Come on, Ken. We're at the Christmas market in Vienna. You meet Ken.
Yay.
Pretty affectionate.
Yeah, isn't he? He's overly affectionate.
Hey, on you.
Boy, he's just a real schmoozer.
This is the palace.
Oh, this way. Look, we gotta go this way.
This is the Schloss Cafe.
When we get back, Joe, you can get.
Alright, let's go in there and see what's up. Here we are. Going in to meet the Duchess. Thank you. gift shop. Good morning.
Quite a funny history of a woman leading this castle and this this place. You have Franz Ferdinand, who married to Sophie Kotek, and he knew that he needed a place for his wife to be in case of an emergency, in case of an accident. And that's why Aachen was already supposed to be a widow's place. And then two generations later on, it was always the women who organized to stay on place here, to organize the castle, to organize the surroundings. So Aachen is a very feminine place to be. And last year, that's the good thing, is, so my mother, Anita Hohenberg, leads Aachen for now 15 years. And last year she passed over to the museum to my sister Alix while I'm in Vienna.
But I'm very lucky because I have three brothers. Ah. And they're always coming when I'm called. So today.
So where are we, Dorothy?
First, oh, this is the Milk Monastery?
Abbey.
Abbey.
Benedictine Abbey. This is a courtyard here. In the first courtyard.
Right? I said 18.
What are you looking
at? What is it? I said 18. You said no. What is it?
What's my wife?
Okay, so we can also.
What are you taking
there? So we'll go through the top, right?
Well, yeah. First, I want to try to find my wife.
This is
Vienna. This is it. This be the Abbey.
John, first courtyard?
Yep, right here.
So we should wait right here. But we can wait underneath.
Oh, wow. It's nice and cozy.
Okay. That's sort of infectious way of speaking. It's deliberate. Okay, you have to say that again.
Regensburg. You are in Regensburg.
Okay, now everybody knows where we are.
Look at Dan. You don't have anything on your throat. No scarf. Like you think you're in Florida. No hat.
Well, we're going to get ready to walk through that town.
This was the northeast corner of the Roman fortification, constructed in 179 AD under the Roman Emperor Marcus Aurelius. This fortification was 450 to 540 meters. And there was a legion stationed here, the third Italian legion. That means 6,000 legionary soldiers were stationed here. And around this old fortification, there lived about 2nd century up to the 5th century. Well, could you please come a little bit to this? So we are now in front of the Cathedral of Regensburg. This cathedral here was constructed from 1275 to 1520. You see, about 250 years were necessary to construct this cathedral, and then it was finished. But only the towers, the high towers, the flesh of the towers, they were finished in the 19th century. Because by the end of the Middle Ages, the people didn't have enough money to complete. And the Bavarian King Ludwig I, he completed it in the 19th century. And if you imagine that in the Middle Ages they only have had wooden bridges, ship bridges, only smaller stone bridges, but not a bridge like this. This bridge was hundreds of years. It's the only firm connection over the total Danube. Neither Vienna nor Budapest had firm bridges. Then you can see how important this bridge was in the Middle Ages. A very important trade way. Yeah? Well, and now it is in restoration. It needs a restoration.
Okay, it's down there. This is the Danube.
It is the oldest sausage kitchen of the world. And first it was the kitchen for the workers of the old stone bridge, and now it is the sausage kitchen, roasted sausages, pork sausages, the sauerkraut and sweet mustard and kipferl, a special bread, is offered there. This is a specialty. We say it is the oldest fast food restaurant
too small. Then, ladies and gentlemen, please don't forget at 11:15 we are starting with the Bavarian traditions. It's going to be the Frühschoppen.
See where these crazy people are.
Hi.
Holy mackerel.
Getting ready for our Nuremberg trip. There's one of the prettiest girls in the place, right there.
Oh, you make me blush.
She's not really English either.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to our adventure to Nuremberg. Well, my name is Christoph, and I'm going to be your tour guide for today. Just wanted to show you my face because right now I'm going to vanish here to the front out of security reasons. How are you today, by the way?
Great, good.
Great? That's great to hear. Wunderbar, we say here.
Wunderbar.
In Nuremberg, we are starting our tour with a more grimmer past of the city with the Nazis and the Nazi Party rally grounds. There I'm going to explain to you why Nuremberg was such an important city for Adolf Hitler, why he used Nuremberg for his propaganda, especially the long and wonderful medieval history of Nuremberg. So it was a never finished. But if it would have been finished, the sole purpose of this building would have been one speech once a year by Adolf Hitler in front of 50,000 people. That was it. Pretty much shows the megalomaniac Adolf Hitler behind it. More like the crazy megalomaniac Adolf Hitler. You can still see those concrete noses up there, going around there. That's where the seats should have been. And what Hitler intended with this building, he used it for his propaganda, of course. And what he wanted to show here, that he was the savior, the messiah of the German people. So he wanted to show a pseudo-religious idea. In a way, it should be like a church. Well, he stole lots of ideas from the Catholic and Protestant Lutheran Church, especially the Germans were always avid churchgoers. But Hitler never really trusted the church. He wanted to get rid of them, but never managed that. But he wanted to take over this idea of being the savior of the German
people. Bricks.
So if this building would have been finished, it should have a small glass ceiling atop the grandstand of Adolf Hitler, which would have been there to our front side, the entrance where we entered, that's where the grandstand should have been of Adolf Hitler. And the idea of this glass ceiling, it should illuminate the grandstand in Adolf Hitler. Another idea is, the further away from Hitler you sat, the further up you sat, the more in darkness you would be. But the closer down you came, the closer towards Adolf Hitler you came, the more illuminated you would become.
Altars made a place where sacrifices were made. The center of the Greek city. Hitler had his grandstand right here in the middle. So this was there. In front of those troops began to be fallen and unfallen. And he could have been born. Then the medieval history of Nuremberg, that we lived in the history of Nuremberg, this could look like, well, maybe the fortress on the outside. 34 stone towers. They're much taller, when you see them in person. And well, it should kind of protect the city. So inside, it should create this feeling of belonging together, of having the same destiny, so something further, to have a savior than made them. And another thing, it should not just protect them, but also keep them together. Later on it was used for the other pillar. Then. And then this national ethnic community had another pillar called the racist part, the German Aryan race. It's superior to all the others.
The stone tower is in the picture.
Inside Germany itself, the Allies seize the famous stadium of Nuremberg, scene of countless Nazi party rallies. With the capture of this famous southern German city, the American flag blouts out the swastika. In a symbolic gesture, American troops destroy the Nazi party emblem.
Who was charged? Well, in the first main trial, 24 people who got captured were charged. Well, Adolf Hitler wasn't among them. Joseph Goebbels, the propaganda minister, wasn't among them. And Heinrich Himmler, chief of the SS, this very brutal paramilitary organization which was mainly responsible for the mass killings and the Holocaust. They committed suicide before or right after the war. So, those 24 people, I have to tell you, even not everyone showed up. One person was too old and too sick. He was in his 90s, Alfred Krupp. steel magnet of the Krupp factories. Lots of slave laborers were employed as slave laborers, died in those companies. So, actually, they wanted to have a son, which later was tried in a follow-up trial.
Then, one person committed suicide, 1 week before the trial started.
And one person was tried in absentia. That was Martin Bormann, the secretary of Adolf Hitler. Later on, they found the remains of Martin Bormann in the 1970s in Berlin. Seems like he died during the Battle of Berlin. But still, he was tried. So he didn't know that.
I guess we're in the international section or something. The market. Christmas market. Groove line.
What a group. What a group.
Sorry.
Don't drop it.
I gotta drink this stuff. I cut. Yeah. You know, Christmas markets in Nuremberg.
We thought everybody was out here because we came out
the bus.
Anybody, so we came out.
Okay.
No,
you've got the group. You've got the group color on today.
There we go.
You're in the orange.
Orange color. Yes, yeah. That's
make sure you're with the right group.
I like the color.
They carried you right out. It's very pretty. Okay.
We did
look
it.
At this
we did
bus. It's yes. Got a kitchen.
Oh, good.
Glushing. Glushing. We should have sat in the back because it's facing. Where can I put this?
Up, up. Is there any?
No.
Going to the marketplace and then to Marienplatz, St. Mary's Square, which is the very center and the very beginning of the town, because then at noon the Glockenspiel will play. Please, I know the timing. I know sometimes the guests, they become a bit nervous, you know, 10 to 12 approaching, they're not yet there. At 12 o'clock first, the bells start to ring. and then we have the first tunes, and then only with the second tunes, the figures are moving. So we won't miss it, I promise you. I guess I saw that you are all fit, so in case we are walking a bit faster then. Okay, and let's start now, just not to stay here forever, and let's start out here.
The first floor, you will see a kind of a copy. They show you how it looked like in former times, so I can promise you, we are living now in a very much more comfortable standard and circumstances. Because in those times, we were just one big hall, you know, in a front room,
they were eating,
and
they were sleeping.
The big giant, just unique has to be full. And it's all possible. You might ask why that. I ask you sometimes as well, because Munich is more and more the most expensive city in whole Germany. And it attracts so many people. Let's say the younger generation, the younger people, they prefer to live in the cities rather than in the countryside. And then Munich has a lot of good companies with a lot of good jobs to offer. You know, not only the BMW car or Audi is not so far away. You have the Siemens company, the insurance, Allianz, the publishing sector, film industry, the fashion a little bit. Now here, the famous Hofbräu House. So now we first a few lessons of German. The Bräu house, you know, it's very easy. It's a house. Bräu, that's a brewery. And Hof, H-O-F, Hofbräu House, that's the brewery of the court. So we had for almost 740 years, there was one noble family. I told you 1158, the foundation, only 22 years later, they took over. And so it's very easy for you and as well for us tour guides to remember not many dynasties, just one family, the Wittelsbach family. So they took over in 1180. And they have maybe a religious holiday.
This is it. Same size as the cabin on the boat. Tomorrow, 6 o'clock, we're heading for the airplane. Pretty plain. Plain, okay. Off of that.